Okay, so welcome to this lessons learned on upgrades. Just a quick introduction about who we are. So I'm Frédéric Lepied. I am in charge of engineering at the RCIP. The RCIP is a Red Hat Cloud Innovation Practice. So it's a new entity that is bridging the service and product organizations inside Red Hat. And I am managing the engineering team in this organization.
He's my manager.
Yeah.
So I have to do well today. So my name is Emilian. I'm working in the installer team. I'm a software engineer. And my specialization is automation in OpenStack, and specifically Puppet. And
that's it. So don't hesitate if you have any questions, so raise your hand and go to the mic and ask your question. So it doesn't work. Okay, fuck. No. So just a quick disclaimer, the examples we are going to use during these presentations are more for former Innovance tools and products, and that's not Red Hat ones. So Red Hat ones will use different technologies, but the philosophy behind the tools and how you do upgrades will be the same. So OpenStack is a wonderful place, but as you know, upgrades are not easy. So just a quick check. Who is doing upgrades in production? Raise your hand. Okay. So who doesn't suffer from upgrades? Okay. Well, one, good. So let's see how we define an upgrade, because everybody has a different definition of what is an upgrade, so to be sure that we are on the same line. What we feel, what we define as an upgrade, a successful upgrade, is when you don't need to add new hardware to manage your upgrade. You don't need to add additional capacity. Of course, what is very important is to have the less interruption possible, targeting, of course, without interruption. And we are also dealing with minor upgrades, like you just have to a security fix you want to pass on your systems, or major upgrade, meaning a full OpenStack, a new major version of OpenStack, for example. And of course, what we want is something that is efficient, fast, and reproducible. So during this presentation, our roadmap is to speak about the importance of the architecture, the importance of having free capacity to be able to move around the VM, for example, and also that's a little bit optional, but that's how we work. We feel that image-based deployment and image-based workflow is the key to be reproducible and to ease the deployment. And automation is the number one thing to think about when you do an upgrade.
Thanks. So let's talk about the architectures. So this is not, we are not going to go deep in the architectures in OpenStack. So whatever architecture you are using in your platform, it needs to be redundant. That means you need HA, not only for infra services, but only for OpenStack resources. In this picture, you can have a look, we are using some tools to provide HA. It's obviously this picture is not complete, and we are missing a lot of pictures to show that some OpenStack resources needs to be HA. If you take an example in networking, you need to provide HA for the virtual routers, which is a feature that is in Neutron from Juno. So this architecture is just an example at how we used to deploy OpenStack at Innovance before. We used to run, for example, for the storage, we used to run Ceph, which is a backend for the Nova and Cinder component of OpenStack. We also run Swift as a backend for Glance. For the HA in database, we are using MySQL Galera and MongoDB with a replica set and sharding. So this is just an example of what you will need to deploy if you want HA in your platform. And we are seeing again that you really need to have HA if you want to upgrade your platform anyway.
So why do you need HA?
Why do we need HA? Because the way that we upgrade OpenStack, you will see in the next slides, we are interrupting some service and we actually count off services themselves to fail over and to have the intelligence to switch to another node that is working. So we are trying to have the less downtime possible during the upgrade workflow. So one of the biggest requirements when you want to upgrade, and specifically for the compute nodes at scale, you need some free capacity. In the previous talk, Matt said that you need to evacuate some VMs when it works. You need some free capacity. If you have a ton of VMs, you would like to evacuate the compute nodes before the upgrade. Also, you will need some spare for the controllers. If something's wrong and you would like to fall back, having a spare sometimes is a good idea.
So this part is more optional. You saw in the previous presentation that people are using packages to upgrade their system and to install their system. We believe that image-based workflow is easier to reproduce and to install and upgrade your system. So the basic thing is that you build these images only once, and you reuse them as much as you want, and you can reinstall, I don't know, 3 months later, you will have exactly the same thing. So that's something can be important. You install using your images, of course, and you upgrade using your images. And the main point is that when you upgrade, when you are upgrading a system or you are, when you are installing a system, you will have the exact same bits at the end. So it will be the exact same files, exact same content on your systems, whether you upgrade or whether you install. So you build your images with a set of tools. And of course, you use a CI system to build your images. But now it's just everybody is doing this in a CI system. Of course, you can use tools like Disk Image Builder. We have our own tool to build images. You can choose whatever tools you want. Of course, you use packages to build the images themselves, not to upgrade the system, but to build these images, and then you compress them and you archive them. And like I said, you can reuse them as much as you want. So in 1 year later, you can still do the exact same installation if you have a customer that is calling you for an old installation. There is no problem to reproduce it. Of course, your version, all your sources, and you stamp your archive of your image with the exact same ID or version, and this way you can track whatever was in this image at the source level without problem. And of course, as we are cloud using cloud, you archive them in a cloud storage, in an object storage, Swift or Ceph, for example. Our experience is that we at the beginning we were using a lot of different images, one for each role, one for the compute, one for the controller, one for the networking. And we had to do a lot of different architecture, and at the end it was an explosion of images, and it was very difficult to manage all this combinatory. So what we did is that we stopped to build all these images. And we built only two images, one for the installation server and one for the OpenStack services, with all the services installed, but nothing activated. And then configuration management will activate the service when needed on the nodes. And this way it's easier, we have only two images for the full for a full deployment. What we did also is that we are deactivating, in fact, the package manager inside the images to prevent system administrator from using these tools during their work. In fact, this way we can keep the system consistent, and that's easy to reproduce the exact same one because you know nothing has been touched. And it's auditable very easily. The other characteristic of doing deactivating this package tools is that it speed up a lot Puppet or Chef, etc., because they don't need to. They always try to update the package cache and to do this kind of stuff. And with this deactivating, it's a no-op operation, so it's very fast, and you speed up your configuration management. Of course, we don't remove them from the system, because in case of emergency, you can want to re-enable them. So we have some ways to put them back if needed, or if really needed. So just a small comparison of if you use the package tools to upgrade one system, it's very slow and it's very hard to scale. That's the number is around 20 minutes to upgrade the system. The other drawback is that you need to manage your repositories, and you need to be able to freeze them, to be able to have something reproducible on all your system, and using images. That's very you don't have to bother with all these repositories. And it's the other advantage is that it's very fast. It's roughly 20 seconds per node to go from one version to another one. And the big advantage that you cannot do with package management is that you can go back. In fact, you can roll back to a previous version if you have some troubles.
Okay, so we talked about the image-based deployment. Now we are going to see how we actually upgrade the systems. So some pieces are taken from the previous slides. We are going first to understand how do we run the actual upgrade on the system, which tool we are using, and how it works. After that, we will see the configuration updates. We will understand how to make some orchestration around that. And finally, we will see the whole picture. So we have a slide with the workflow that we like to upgrade the platform. So what do you need to upgrade an image? So when you do image deployment, it's very special comparing to packaging system. You don't use apt-get dist upgrade to update your system. This is a little bit more complicated. You need a tool to upgrade your system. we are using eDeploy, which is a tool that uses the AirSync technology. This is very straightforward. We are doing an AirSync between the master and the node that we would like to update. This way, we don't manage the service upgrade. We don't manage the service restart. This is done later. I will explain the orchestration part. And this way also, it's a possibility of rollback. So I don't know if you was in the talk before, but they talk about the virtual environment in Python they want to use. So this way is also another option. If you would like to have a rollback option, you can actually upgrade your image and roll back to the previous one if something's wrong. And thanks to your orchestration tool, you can manage the service restarting easily. So I think whatever tool you're using for configuration, the best one is the one that you already have and the one that you already masterize. So we are using Puppet, but I think some of you are using some other tools. I think you need two things when you use this, these tools. First of all, you need to be able to update the config between the during the upgrade process, and you also need to be able to not manage the packaging during the when you run Puppet or Chef or whatever. You need to avoid the packaging calls because we don't update the packages with Puppet. We use edeploy, like I said. For the orchestrator, we are thinking about Ansible. So Puppet and Chef are very good for configuration, and we thought about using Ansible for orchestration, multiple systems in the same time. Ansible has this position here where it takes the responsibility of restarting the services in the right order, which is very difficult to manage when you have a cluster that you want to upgrade. So Ansible is very good at this because you can control exactly what you want to do at the right time. And while Puppet will just take care of upgrade the configuration and make sure the service is running. Also, during the orchestration, we will see later in the big picture at what time we are upgrading the image. So this is like a general workflow of how do we upgrade a node. We are running some actions before the upgrades. Sometimes it can be just do a backup or add some SSH key or something very specific to the platform. After that, we used to evacuate the resources. So that can be VMs, routers, storage, or whatever we would like to evacuate to another node to avoid any downtime, actually. After that, we stop the OpenStack services, and right after, we stop the infra services. So what is infra services? We call infra like service like MySQL, HAProxy, or any system-related application that we would like to stop before the upgrade. And then we run the upgrade, so we upgrade the packaging. So we don't use the packaging tool for this. We use rsync. So that will just in a few seconds that will upgrade the whole image, that will upgrade the new OpenStack or the new software that you have on your image, and then Ansible come back and make sure that you start the service after the upgrade, make sure that you upgrade your database if needed. And so on. So we have an example here with evacuating and migrating a compute node. So I have an example of code after this slide of playbook, but this slide is just about explain like the very high level workflow that we think about. So like I said, you evacuate your instance. You disable Nova Compute to make sure that you are not scheduling a new VM on the node that you want to upgrade. You update the system, you update the config, you make sure that the services are running, like libvirt, Nova Compute, the networking, the Celometer agent, etc. And by the end, you test if the services are actually running.
That's something that people did not so long ago because of a Venom threat, in fact. Yeah.
So this is an example of snippets. So what is a snippet? This is a piece of Ansible code. So we thought about creating a snippet per service we would like to upgrade. So this one is an example. This is not a snippet that we use for production. This is just an example of code. We have an action to evacuate the compute. We have an action to restart the service. And we have a last action to enable Nova Compute. please have a look at the tags. This is important for the next slide. We are using the tags in Ansible to do the ordering in the when we want to make some ordering in the different action that we are composing. So how to write the snippets today? I think most of people in the room are using some tools to upgrade, like Ansible or Puppet or whatever, but they used to write these tools manually, and we thought about how could we generate these playbooks, because they used to be very repetitive between upgrades. If you are using to upgrade OpenStack every release, you will see that it's usually always the same actions. You need to stop some services, you need to upgrade the DB, you need to update some configuration, and you need to start a service. This is most of the case, this kind of actions. So we are writing a library which is some snippets of Ansible code, and we have one snippet per service that can be an OpenStack service but also a system service. So that way we have a library of snippets that we are going to generate. We are going to generate the whole playbooks later with a tool, but first you need to understand how to upgrade a specific service. So for that, you need to compute what is upgraded in an image. So if you build a new image, you need to understand what you are going to upgrade, which services are upgrading. And you also need to understand which services are running on each node. So you need to make automation around this, because when you have a lot of deployments, most of the case they don't use the same architectures, so you don't want to repeat the same process manually every time. So before showing you the whole picture of how do we generate those Ansible playbooks, we try to respect some Ansible best practices. The first one is we use the tags in the snippets to define ordering. So that means you can write some snippets for some services, and if you know that an action has to be run before another one, which is maybe in another snippet, you can make sure that you are using a tag which is lower than the other one. That's why if you look at this slide, each point is actually an Ansible tag. So when you write the snippets, you have to take care about the tags and for the ordering. This is very important, especially when you are running a cluster. For the HA nodes, like the controllers, we are running Ansible in serial, node after node, and of course we stop if something's wrong. We don't want to break everything, so if something's wrong, we can detect it and stop it. For the compute, we are running the Ansible playbooks in parallel, so you can have a faster upgrade process. The tool tries to be able to restart but to continue the upgrade process. If something's wrong and you have to make a pause, you can actually continue the upgrade process easily. And like I said, we have a snippet per service. So this is the whole picture of how we can generate the Ansible playbook per role. So a role can be a controller or compute node, for example. So to make a quick summary, we build a new image. We are computing the difference between the previous one, and we make an analysis of the change. In parallel of this, we are to know which services are running on each node. We are using the Puppet API to query the catalog of the remote nodes, so we can know which services and which packaging, which services are running on each node, And so we can compute by using some tools to understand what we actually need to upgrade, which services we need to upgrade, and make this association between the snippets and the services managed by Puppet. This is an example with Puppet. Obviously, you can use the same thing with any tool. So when you have your association between what you are running on the nodes and how to upgrade the services, you generate the Ansible playbooks. And if you try the tool, you will see at the end, you will get some playbooks per role, which should have the right orchestration and which should upgrade the right services on the nodes.
So just to conclude, just the four things you need to remember from this talk is that if you want less interruption possible, you need HA in your architecture for your OpenStack deployment. If you want to be able to evacuate your VM or your vRouter, you need free capacity. So you need to be able to compute your free capacity before launching an upgrade. That's very important. Image-based, that's an option that is very useful for us, but you can choose whatever you want if you want to use your package manager. But that's working too. You saw the previous presentation, it's working. And orchestration and configuration management are key. So if you don't have this in place, it will be very difficult for you to do upgrades. And that's it. Can show the next one.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So we put this URL if you want to take a look at the snippets. It's on GitHub. You will see the list of the different available snippets that we developed. If you want to contribute, you're welcome, of course. And if you want to tweet, be our guest. Now, questions.
Yeah, thanks. Very good points. I had a question. You mentioned that you upgrade your control nodes, HA nodes, in serial so that you can roll back. So when you're upgrading your HA nodes one at a time, how do you validate that the services are up afterwards? So is that part of Ansible orchestration?
This is a good question. So when you upgrade your system, so you upgrade first, let's say you have three controllers, you would like to upgrade the, so you are like in the process to upgrade the image, so you stop the service. Obviously, mm-hmm. This is a HA node, so the service is still running somewhere.
Right.
Okay, so you upgrade the system, and then you start again the application, so the application is joining the cluster.
Correct.
We haven't talked about this, but we are using server spec to validate that Puppet is actually doing what we expect to during the deployment process and also during the upgrade process. Mm-hmm. So you can use whatever tool you like, but like server spec is a good example if you would like to do integration testing in Puppet here, but you can have Chef also.
Right.
And server spec is able to detect if the cluster is up and running during the upgrade process.
Okay, thanks. Also, just a follow up on that. So, you know, do you follow the serialization of your HA nodes just for upgrade, or you do that for your regular install as well?
Can you just repeat this?
So, the serialization of upgrade for your HA nodes, right? But do you recommend following the same for a regular install, or is it just for upgrade?
Oh, I think for the serialization is important when you are doing clustering. You need to bootstrap a master node usually,
correct.
So
correct.
That's why we are doing
right.
serial.
So it's regardless of whether you're upgrading, you should serialize your HA node bringer.
This
right.
is the same process for
right.
Bootstrapping and also upgrading. This is the same process usually.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi. Do you have all this matter is pretty complex? So, do you have this the same information that you have here? Here is high level, But do you have something similar in low level, like very with details to go somewhere and look at it?
So the question is, you want to go deep and you want to try it right now.
Yep.
This is something that we are working on currently.
Okay.
So some parts of it are already documented, and they are already working in the former product of Innovens. You can.
Is there any URL that we can go?
Yeah, the e-deploy part, you can go on github.innovens.com/e-deploy. So you will have the tool to do the image-based upgrades and image-based build. The Ansible part is available also. Yeah. You can use it. The snippets, you use the link that is here, and you can use them. But just the computation of the differences between images that we are in the process of pushing in the Git repositories.
So if you are interested by seeing what we did in the former installer of Innovens, you can go on the website spinalstack.innovens.com, which is what we used before. And so most of the concepts are already documented, and you can have some pointers to the code and explain how it works. So you have the basic structure here if you want to have a look.
Can I tweet you with asking you for those URLs and stuff?
Sure thing, yeah, yeah,
sure. Okay. No problem.
Thank you.
Hi, I just have a question. Do you use this process for doing major upgrades, say between Juno and Kilo and things like that?
Any upgrades.
Yeah,
it can
sure.
be a minor, okay. It can be a major.
So I'm interested because typically one of the biggest problems with those kind of upgrades is the database. It's thinking of the data models. So I'm trying to understand when you go into the controller. So let's say you have three controllers with Galera, so they're clustered. You go into the first node, you upgrade it. You then need to do the new DB sync, which will run on that node, which will then get synchronized to your other controllers and break them because the data model is now behind what the code is on the other controllers?
That's a good question. When you run the DB sync, you have to take care of what time you do it. Usually, in my experience, we are using the DB sync at the end of the upgrade. So when you upgrade three controllers, you want to run the DB sync at the end, and then you can start the services.
So okay, so there is potentially a little bit of downtime between the major,
yeah.
Which is fine. I mean, it's pretty much.
I think an upgrade without downtime, like zero downtime, doesn't exist.
Today. Yeah, yeah, I agree. Yeah.
On the paper, maybe, but not here.
Like for minor updates, it's fine, but for like the big ones, you're always gonna. Yeah, no, that's cool. That clarifies a lot. Thank you.
But it's a downtime of the APIs. The VMs continues to run.
Yes, of course. Yeah, exactly. So. And obviously projects like, I think Nova's the first one, they're doing better stuff across major versions with the data model and stuff, so it should become easier over time.
Yeah. Thanks. Any question? Okay, thank you very much.
So thank you.